this week that I've had to follow media and television superstars. Earlier in the week, I had to follow Vice President Gore. I was somewhat nervous. How do you follow that? And if you follow media and news, as I have over the last few decades, no one is probably more familiar than Nick. So I will do my best to live up to Nick's example. It's interesting to come after BMW. Carbon Tracker often talks about incumbents and how most incumbents fail to deal with technological and other transitions. If that were not true, the cars that we drive would be manufactured by steam locomotive manufacturers. These cameras you have and the cameras in your smartphones would be manufactured by Kodak. And the chains of video shops, Blockbuster in the UK, would be the people you'd stream your videos from. But there are some companies who are an exception to that rule. Does anybody know what BMW used to manufacture before they manufactured cars? Planes. And when they could no longer manufacture planes, they were one of the companies that succeeded in innovating and transforming themselves as a company. And I think it is clear from what we've heard today that we see that this is one of the companies who looks likely to survive this transition. Now, why would the CEO of Carbon Tracker be on a panel about carbon pricing? Anyone who follows our work, we talk about carbon bubbles and the risk of stranded assets. And you may have seen the article overnight from Reuters, from sort of floods in Bangladesh to the Bank of England, a carbon bubble is born. And there is a real risk, even though we've heard all the positive stories, and I think many in this room will be part of the transition, will be part of the new companies and the new economy. We still face a risk from the old economy that a huge amount of value will be destroyed. The top 200 oil and gas companies have spending plans to develop yet more oil and gas that would amount to deploying $6 to $7 trillion of capital over the next decade. Those spending plans would add up to something like $35 to $40 trillion poured into yet more oil, gas and coal over the next 2 to 3 decades. That's money that we critically need to fund the transition. So if you think about it, if that value is destroyed, we need to find it again to fund the low carbon transition. So it's a sort of double whammy. But a carbon price, in my view, I'm passionate, I've spent much of my career trying to build carbon markets before Carbon Tracker, is probably one of the most effective and efficient ways to transform the policy signal that we are looking for here in Paris into a financial market signal that will help us avoid that value destruction. Now, we have a fantastic panel. Perhaps I could ask the panel to join me up here, I think, to explore this issue. Now, as Rachel Kite said at a presentation the other day, I think what we cannot expect out of the Paris Agreement is a sort of magic wand, like Dumbledore, to sort of magically create a global carbon market and a global carbon price. The Paris Agreement will probably not even mention carbon pricing. Yet we know that carbon prices are being created around the world in multiple jurisdictions. So I think we've got an opportunity here to explore how Paris can help us from the experience we've had in different jurisdictions, and there's a lot of experience here on the panel, to actually take the policy signal that comes out of Paris, which I think we're all reasonably confident we will get, and through carbon pricing and other mechanisms, turn that into an effective financial signal that helps us gently deflate the carbon bubble and not burst it, and avoids creating stranded assets over the next decades. So we have Rita Schutzler-Stutter, a parliamentary state secretary for the German Ministry of Environment, Conservation, Building and Nuclear Safety. Tim Grosser, minister responsible, is Tim's not here? Okay. Wayne Sharp, chairman and founder of the Carbon Trade Exchange. Ingrid Blond, chief financial officer and deputy chief executive officer for Vattenfall, And last but not least, Amoli Amin, Chief Climate Change and Chief of the Climate Change and Sustainability Division for the Inter-American Development Bank. Now, I'm going to introduce our speakers in more detail as I ask some questions. So I'm going to start with Rita. And Rita, before her current position, has served on a number of delegations on behalf of the German government. Particularly, she headed the German delegation at the Small Islands Development Conference and the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development negotiations. Since 2014, Rita has been on the Board of Trustees and Chairman of the German Federal Environmental Foundation and Chairman of the Society for Plant and Reactor Safety. Now, in environment, in low-carbon transitions, I mean, Germany is a leader in many fronts. Your mechanisms to fund and deploy renewable energy, I mean, are world-leading, and have probably helped put us in the position we are with renewables more than any other country. But you've also had extensive experience of carbon pricing through the European Emissions Trading Scheme. Could you talk a little bit about that practical experience in Germany? How has that worked? What have been the problems and what have been the successes of being part of a bigger regional carbon market?
Thank you. I'm very pleased that this year's Sustainable Innovation Forum is once again being kicked off with a discussion on carbon pricing and markets. And this clearly shows how important these instruments are for climate action and also for sustainable development. And we talk also, we hear the Ministry of Mineco, it is also a very important measure. And the fact that carbon pricing and carbon markets have spread rapidly over the past few years shows that more and more people now believe that the price needs to be put on greenhouse gas emissions. I think that's very important that the thinking about that we have to put a price on greenhouse emissions, we have a common understanding. So we should continue to encourage this positive development, and countries need carbon pricing instrument in order to efficiently implement mitigation action targets and action. In addition, companies need powerful incentives for investments in low carbon technology and to be able to play their part in decarbonizing the global economy. And the arguments for carbon pricing and carbon market instruments are convincing, and our experience with the EU emissions trading scheme have been positive. The CAP ensures that the predefined emissions reduction target will be reached, and the target is reached at least cost for the economy, as mitigation takes place where at most cost efficient. And furthermore, companies have the utmost flexibility when, where, and how they reduce their emissions. And in companies, reducing CO2 emissions is no longer solely a matter for engineers. Instead, identifying emission reduction potential is now part, should be part, and is part of strategic corporate planning. Investment and innovation incentives are provided that can help reducing emissions intensity and encourage a sustainable transformation. And surveys show that the EU ETS has raised companies' awareness for their carbon costs and mitigation potential, which has led to behavioral charges and also to cost effectiveness and saving of costs. And to make long-term investment decisions, companies need a robust set of rules. Therefore, in the EU, we have made emissions trading crisis proof with the market response, market stability reserve, and we are working on the creation of ambitious long-term price signals. It was not very easy, but Germany wanted to implement this market stability reserve a little bit sooner, but now we have it before 2020, so it's also okay. and the revenues generated from auctioning allowances can be used to especially promote projects necessary for long-term green economic growth, so you can promote the new technologies. In Germany, all auction revenues go towards the Energy and Climate Fund. And with this money, you can finance these projects. They are used, for example, to promote energy efficiency projects, also in the building sector, or innovative projects in the industry or in heat generations using renewable energy. And our renewable energy percentage is 33%, and I think it's remarkable when we made the Renewable Energy Act in 2001. So it's the combination of the ETS and the Climate and Energy Fund, and also we had feed-in tariffs that make us successful in this transformation with the renewable energies. And through the NRE 300, that's the new new enhanced reserve of the EU, a special reserve in the ETS, the EU is already funding innovative low-carbon energy demonstration projects. And for the fourth ETS trading period, the Commission proposed to expand this fund to support innovative low-carbon technologies in industry sectors. I think that's also an incentive for some member states in the EU to take part, and we can convince that we drive the emission trade system further. So the emission trading as such gives these incentives in the short to middle term and improves the market position of low carbon technologies, and for the long term, strategies like the development of new technologies and to overcome non-monetary barriers, for example, in the field of renewable energies, further instruments are needed like the feed-in tariffs or something else. So I think we can have demonstrated that we are a highly industrialized country, that we are competitive, and we can also bring further renewable energies.
Thank you. Encourage you to put some questions in. We're getting questions that are coming in. There's a couple of questions around linking and how if the Paris Agreement does not link carbon markets, does not create a sort of obvious framework for flexible mechanisms, how do we link these mechanisms and obviously get the cost and efficiencies from a sort of linked carbon market? Now, I know a man who's good at building infrastructure and linking markets, Wayne Sharp, chairman and founder of Carbon Trade Exchange. So Wayne designed and founded the Carbon Trade Exchange back in 2007. He's been doing a huge amount of work to put infrastructure in around the world for carbon markets and environmental markets. Prior to founding Carbon Trade Exchange, he founded Bartercard, which I'm sure many, many people are familiar with. During his tenure, that facilitated over $40 billion in trade via more than 30 million transactions in 20 countries. Now, Wayne, you know, how can business, if we're not going to get a framework handed down to us from on high via the international negotiations for a carbon market, how can businesses step in, businesses in the financial markets, to assist in developing effective carbon markets, not just isolated markets in one country after another, but a true global market built bottom up from individual countries?
Yeah, thanks, Anthony. I think that from the top down's perspective, the German situation is just a fabulous example. I mean, they had literally exponential growth, more than 1.5 times per year, every year, from when they engaged their domestic policy in renewable energy. So, you know, 1.5 times per year in growth in that sector. Of course, what fantastic job creation, what business opportunities and re-engineering the economy. And of course, what that enabled businesses to do is to then take financial advantage of the EU ETS strategies. And the trading opportunities that emerge from those. So I look at this as being something where we want to provide the trading technologies, yes, for the regulated entities that need and have to trade, but also the whole idea of the EU ETS is a stick and a carrot. It's designed as a stick to force some reduction in emission targets, and those have been phenomenally successful. I have a slide here that shows quickly, if you don't mind, it's slightly off the question, but this is from, I brought this from COP21, one of the side events that I was a participant in, and this is previously CDC Climate, which is the French government institution for research and analysis. If we go to the next slide, it shows what they expect to happen in the EU ETS and what the targets are. And this is pretty amazing. All this stuff about the government levers, well, a lot of people don't realise those levers have already been pulled and they haven't had any detrimental effect on the European pricing. It's now started to recover from some of the issues of oversupply and so forth, but the targets are incredible. But look at this target up the top here. They achieved 24% when they targeted 21% emission reduction from pricing. And yes, there was a massive monumental recession in the middle of all this, and you know, the global financial crisis, let's not forget. So clearly the impact of that tailed in the pricing model afterwards. But the target is now 43%. So there's a huge amount of opportunity still in Europe to come. Well, where does business fit into all this? I mean, how does this flow down into the business community? In my view, there's nothing to stop you from pricing carbon in your business and using it in the same way as a financial stick and a carrot within your organisation to get more productivity, less waste and a better financial result. Danske Bank is probably one of the great examples I can think of that did this very successfully. It took them 2 years back in 2005-2007 to do a carbon neutrality program. They measured their emission footprint and priced carbon within their business, all the subsectors. Now, it's not a huge bank, $6 billion in revenue, 23,000 employees, multiple offices in different countries throughout Europe. It cost them €500,000 to go carbon neutral. Now, for $6 billion revenue company, that's not a huge amount of money. And this is private action. This is voluntary action. Not compliance action driven by an EU ETS. This is them deciding the carbon price within their business. Okay, in the space of 2 years, by now knowing where their emission footprint was designed within their business, they targeted reductions, put incentives internally within their business and offered competitions between departments and branches to promote all sorts of different innovative ways to reduce their emission footprint. They reduced it 60% in 2 years. So not only did their cost of carbon neutrality reduce by 60% to €200,000, which is almost nothing for an organisation of that scale, but now they actually identified they saved more than €1.5 million per year in direct cost savings during the course of reducing their emission footprint, mostly from wastage or using more efficient technologies and all sorts of other things. So in actual fact, one of the hidden benefits to all of this is the cost of energy is going down in Germany, for example. Well, guess what? The cost for these guys, they've got €1.5 million of permanent savings from acting on carbon pricing within their business. So what we want to do is provide the different layers. And then you asked about the linkage. Well, the linkage is we've already got a global platform that operates 24/7 for voluntary carbon. What we intend to do is bring all of the different regulated market screens onto one set of screens. So someone who's a large organisation trading internationally or brokers who want to trade, they can trade anything from anywhere, anytime. But for business, it's important to realise you don't actually need to wait for government to tell you what to do. You can be at the front end of the curve, and the more understanding you have of that market, the more likely you're able to gauge in things like BMW have done to make a quite gigantic innovative step forward with their vehicle manufacturing and hopefully be extraordinarily profitable as a result as well. So if you take action, you also have, finally, the moral high ground to engage with your consumer base. And we are just launching this week an innovative tool called Carbon Widget, which allows a company to engage with their clients and be actually paid for the privilege of helping them offset their emission footprint for their individual consumer base. But if you haven't taken action as a company, it's very hard for you to justify asking them to do it. Hence the reason why, while some airlines have had success with their offset programs, a lot haven't, because if they haven't taken action, like Qantas has, and they're their uptake on their voluntary offset program is quite good. The consumers realise if you haven't done anything, maybe they won't. And I think that's the thing. Yes, it's great if you can get government engagement, get pricing, you should be working out how to take advantage of that by engaging. But if not, you can still do it as a company anyway and still be part of an international market doing so.
Wayne, thank you. Our next panellist, Ingrid Bond, and I think it's interesting, the Chief Financial Officer. I think what's fascinating for me at COP21 is how many chief financial officers, CEOs, we've had many CEOs of pension funds at various events, and we've had for the first time at a climate summit, and I would love to know if it's not the first time, but we've been checking and cannot find a previous climate summit, where you have had the governor of one of the world's major central banks and the chair of the Financial Stability Board attend a climate summit, which tells you this is no longer something about the far distant future, even the medium future. This is about financial issues and financial risk today. And of course, again, a clear carbon price is one of the best ways, in my view, to allow businesses to manage that risk. We have a question from Oliver Marchand, CEO of Carbon Delta, about how do you distinguish between risks priced in and systemic risks that are overlooked by investors? Well, if we can get a clear carbon price, I mean, this will be one of the best ways to do that. So, Ingrid, what's Vattenfall's role in developing carbon markets as a large energy company? And I think to that question, does a carbon market help you manage this transition, manage the systemic risks of a low carbon transition and climate change, and as a company, make the leap to the next stage, if you like, the next world, a low carbon economy?
But as you say, I represent a utility sector and a utility company, and as most of you know, after the dramatic fall of energy prices for the last 5-7 years, we're all in agony and pain. We embrace the transformation to renewable society, but we don't longer have the resources and the capacity to do it ourselves. So we need the assistance of the political commitment of the financial sector to do so. And the commitment from the political sector is very, very important. But it is in particular important because it's the enabler for the financial system and the financial investors to know what to do and how to find their path through it. Because this has to be done in combination. And you will only get the full push if the financial sector embrace it and jump in. And right now, they are standing in line more and more to invest in new renewable projects. When I joined 3-4 years ago, they were not. I was a bit surprised because I have a background from the investor community and thought that they would be more interested. But we had enough money then ourselves, and they were also finding alternative investments. They're now standing in line. They are not yet, though, fully deciding on when to divest out of the fossil sector. So whatever deadline the political commitment will give, they will now sort of start to decide when and how to divest before that happens. And as you all know, the financial sector, they're lemmels. They move in herds. So they will start moving. We don't know whether they will start today or tomorrow or closer to the deadline, but once they start, it will go quick. And I think that will be the very interesting movement to watch. And I think that the ETS and the carbon price will be the determining factor for that leapfrog to be made and when it happens. And I think it's quite interesting. We can see bigger and bigger investors truly making a stand. I think, for example, personally, that the fact that even the Norwegian oil fund, representing an oil-dependent country, has now decided to go fossil-free in their investments. One of the bigger investors in the world. So I think it will be very interesting to monitor when and how this will happen. It will go quick once it starts, and I think that the carbon price will be one of the determining factors. And if the political system can make that commitment come true, that might actually accelerate this quicker. And it cannot be done without the financial sector coming in heavily.
No, I totally agree with you. I think one of the things that Carbon Tracker's analysis is beginning to demonstrate is there is a risk premium associated with fossil fuels already that the markets don't see. It's a little bit, the way I characterize what you say is, it's a little bit like that cartoon character many of us grew up with, Roadrunner. And the financial markets are a little bit like this. They keep running head down and they'll run off the edge of the cliff. It'll take them a little bit of time to realize they've run off the edge of the cliff. And again, one of the many reasons we need a carbon price is to help avoid the financial markets running off the edge of the cliff. So if we come to our fourth panelist, what I'm keen to do is explore a little bit about what this means for the developing world. So Amalie Amin, Chief of the Climate Change and Sustainability Division at the Inter-American Development Bank, where she has a wide portfolio of climate change adaptation, mitigation, and knowledge activities for all of Latin America and the Caribbean. Prior, how I knew first knew Amalie was her role at E3G, where she led a program on international climate finance and a lot of in-country work focused on the design and implementation of financing strategies for the low carbon and resilient developments in Latin America, Africa and Asia, so a lot of experience. So, we've talked about this risk that we're going to deploy a lot of capital in the wrong things, that inertia from many of the incumbent companies and the financial markets that I think that Eva picked up on so well. So, in your view, what is the role of the carbon price in incentivizing long-term finance, I think, in the right direction? And possibly also say a little bit about, some countries believe, are desperate to benefit from the fossil fuel bonanza, possibly, after the party has already finished. And again, how can a carbon price help them understand that would be a road to stranded assets and wasted capital?
Thank you, Anthony. I think we met previous to my role at E3G when I was in the UK government.
Yes, many, many years
ago. So. Thanks for this and the opportunity to speak here on this panel, because I think obviously as the negotiations are underway not far away in Le Bourget, these are the key issues that are being explored. What will be the extent to which the Paris Agreement will really drive decarbonisation, will catalyse investors, short-term but also long-term finance? And we've seen here many, many exciting announcements by representatives of the institutional investor community who are all very concerned about this agenda for the reasons that Anthony and others through the Carbon Tracker are focused on, the potential for stranded assets and the risk to their portfolios and the systemic risks actually to the financial sector in many economies. And we at the IDB are starting to really think through this, and I'll come back to that. So in terms of the Paris Agreement, well, hopefully there will be some long-term mitigation goal agreed, so some commitment towards achieving net zero emissions, ideally by 2050 or something similar. And that will clearly send a long-term signal that will start to provide investors with the signals they need to start reallocating assets away from those investments that are inconsistent with that long-term goal. So that is part of it. But at the same time, what is also particularly interesting, I think, about this COP, different to any other we've seen, is we have already national commitments. Countries have put their intended nationally determined contributions on the table. Now, when you look at the total amount of reductions they're going to deliver, they may not be sufficient to stay below the 2-degree threshold at this stage. But they do not actually start till 2020. So it's essential we start to work to implement those and finance those from, I would say, maybe the 2nd of January 2016. And that is something we at the IDB are already focused on and working to scale up and increase our support to countries in that respect, and critically engagement of the private sector. And so that engagement of the private sector, I think, then becomes really essential for the governments and domestic private sectors to start to understand how the different types of tools can best deliver the investment required, with carbon pricing clearly being an important part of that. And we are seeing many countries looking to develop their domestic carbon trading schemes. And at the same time, it may be that whilst providing a positive price for carbon, we also need to recognise there may be contradictory pricing signals in the economy, which, for example, fossil fuel subsidies, which are then diluting that carbon price. So that is also another key part of the agenda that countries need to be focused on at the national level. And in looking at the role of carbon pricing versus feed-in tariffs versus other regulatory measures, I think it's really important to understand what the technology is, what are the key barriers, both financial but also non-financial barriers. So we know that now that renewables have come down in price, you know, in many countries they are cost competitive with alternatives, actually carbon pricing may be the best tool to drive those. We saw and we heard from the German state secretary that certainly in Europe, actually feed-in tariffs had been more appropriate to drive investment in renewable energy technologies because they were higher cost than alternatives. But as the costs have come down, hopefully carbon pricing can become an effective tool. That said, there are other areas, particularly energy efficiency in some sectors where the barriers are not financial. We know energy efficiency is economic, but it isn't necessarily picked up. So you then may need a range of other types of processes and regulatory measures in particular to incentivize investment in that. And I think I just want to refer very briefly to a project that the IDB recently had approved at the Green Climate Fund, working in Mexico and other countries in the region around securitization of energy efficiency projects to create asset-backed green bonds. And we see that as a really important part of the innovation that is required within the financial sector. I think getting back to the point that Lady from Vattenfall made, that we really need to be using public finance, public climate finance, whether it's concessional or MDB, ordinary capital, to targeting some of the specific barriers we see. And I think getting back to, you know, the financial crisis has, you know, certainly set back, if you like, the potential for banks to come into the technologies that we need to see through the concerns over the ability for them to refinance those assets. So the concern of those remaining on their balance sheets. So creating these secondary markets now, using public finance to do that, to innovate, is a really important part of driving the investment we need to see into the technologies. I'll stop now. I wanted to say a little bit more about the INDCs, but maybe we can come back to that.
Well, we've got some good questions coming in. So again, please, you can see question at COP21 Paris.org and or hashtag SIF15 if you want to do it via Twitter. We have someone monitoring that. So just to group the questions, first there's one about price, and maybe Wayne and Amal Lee, I might put that to you. And then secondly, there's one about how do we grow the sort of green and clean energy markets in Europe, which maybe I'll ask Eva to talk out about from sort of Germany's experience and Ingrid as an energy company. So let's take this carbon pricing point, which I think is interesting. And just a comment on that. You know, we see the INDCs, as we are told, add up to 2.7 degrees. So not enough to get us to 2 degrees, but still would represent a cut in emissions of 20 to 30% over the next 3 decades. Yet, you know, the top 200 oil, gas and coal companies are predicting growth for oil, gas and coal of 20 to 30%. So clearly completely incompatible. So what level of carbon price do we need? And how do we set a carbon price? Experience in Europe is good experience of perhaps of how not to set a carbon price or anticipate shocks. To send the right message so that we don't go down this route of growing oil, gas and coal for 20 to 30%, we go down this route of reducing emissions for 30 plus percent, and hopefully overshooting the 2.7 degrees to get us to 2 degrees. So maybe Wayne, if you...
Well, I think that there's a lot of debate as to whether or not there should be any sort of a set price or not. And I think the auction solution, what they've done in California, for example, has worked very well because they set a minimum target on the auction, right, a minimum price on the auctions, and allowed the price to go above that. So they set a floor price of $10. Now, what that floor price did was give financial security for the investment community, because now they know it can't get below that. I actually proposed this in Australia and was ridiculed for doing so. I apologise for being Australian at the moment, by the way, because, you know, they're the Darth Vader of the of COP21. But anyway, it's not my fault. I didn't vote for him. But look, in reality, we've got a situation where companies want to set the carbon price and then offset it at the lowest possible cost. And we've got to be careful, I think, not to make the agenda only about the government stuff, because the government policies are the lever. You know, it's not just that. It's about the business innovation. I mean, there's standard assets. Conversely to that, that means there's gazillions of dollars worth of commercial and business opportunity emerging once you start to understand the opportunities, where the risks and failures are potentially going to be, and where the financial opportunities are going to be. The investment banking community, that's what they want to seek. They want to see the business community be ready to go and penetrate into those opportunities and make money and profit from it to support the policy opportunities, but also for themselves. All of these targets don't include what businesses are doing. They don't include how businesses are pricing carbon within their business, going carbon neutral and reducing their emission footprint, because everyone focuses on the 30% of emission footprint, or 40%, which is the fossil fuel-based, fossil fuel-intensive energy production sector and manufacturing sectors. Well, that's the big ones which the government seeks to lever with its policy. The rest of it is all going to be done by... The difference can very quickly be made up by, some sort of programs within business. And really, a lot of that starts from innovative forums like this, in my opinion, where people have to have the opportunity to understand it doesn't have to be difficult to do. That's why we build technology to do it. It doesn't have to be costly to do. It's why we link with, thousands of projects around the world with our exchange technology. And more importantly, if you make it simple, you make it cost effective, they're more likely to do it voluntarily. But obviously, in the government side of things, they want to make... There's two angles to everything. You can't make it cheap, because if the price is low, the investment community won't support it. So we've got to have a pricing policy throughout everything to say... And look, in a lot of the voluntary offsets, they want to buy what I call a charismatic offset, where it provides a little bit of benefit for social communities, indigenous communities, that type of thing. But some people also want measurable things, like a wind farm in China is measurable. We know that. They don't want to worry about whether someone is or isn't hugging those trees. And at the end of the day, this has got to be a business discussion as much as it is a policy discussion, because when business keeps saying we want a price signal, well, what does that really mean? What we really want is policies that support business creativity and investment into a sector that has a big long-term future, as distinct from the one that's being left behind. And let's face it, when that sector was the big opportunity, we didn't know the problem that was being created as a result of it. Now we do, the science is clear. And at the COP, one thing is for sure, the business hub, which we're sponsoring there as well, is World Business Council of Sustainable Development and the International Emission Trading Association have come together. Yep. There's nearly 300 side events at this thing, and all of them are bringing policymakers, head of the World Bank, UNFCCC head, all of them are coming to that stand for the side events that are all being run in conjunction with business. And business associations, are driving this. The investment community at your event, where Gore spoke, they were basically the investment association saying on behalf of trillions of dollars worth of investment, we want to see this shift, we need a little bit of a nudge from the policy, but we're probably going to do it anyway, because the opportunity, the risk is over here, and in business that's the case. In business, the risk is your competitor does it and you don't, and the opportunity is you do and you look good because you're leading.
Yeah. So, Amalie, can you say something about, I mean, you, as you reminded me, you were in UK government at sort of height of implementing the emissions trading scheme. I think the floor price that the UK put in, unique amongst many of the European countries. But I mean, it strikes me now with, you know, with 2020 hindsight, you know, we missed the, you know, how to deal with massive external shocks. And I always think, imagine if we'd gone into the global financial crisis having set interest rates and money supply for 8 years, but we went into the global financial crisis having set the European carbon price and demand and supply for 8 years, which in hindsight seems like a silly thing to have done. So how should we deal with that sort of price setting or demand and supply, providing business certainty, yet the flexibility to ensure that it works and sends the right signal?
Yeah, well, and just sort of to respond also to the points that Wayne just made, I mean, fully, this is about business and governments forming much stronger dialogue at the country level, I see, because, I mean, the discussion here is fantastic, but we need to take that down to the country level. And still in many countries in our region, that's a relatively early conversation. The new businesses we talk about, whether it's wind industries or the, you know, they may not be a strong presence in many of the countries. They're starting to be in some, which is fantastic, but not all countries. And until those constituencies exist and can bring their concerns to policymakers, to politicians, to congresses, etc., actually the businesses who are vocal in those countries are not the ones who want to move towards the low carbon economy.
But they will come there. They'll follow. If you set something, the entrepreneurs will come there and see the opportunities.
Well, if the policies start to move in that direction, yeah. But the policies may not move in the right direction without that stronger business engagement in country. And so I see that, and that's something we as the IDB, because we have, you know, both public and private sector activities and investments that we will and are, and we will scale this up moving forward, bring together policymakers and businesses, particularly around the INDCs and how the INDCs provide those investment platforms, if you like, for delivering on the investments required for the decarbonisation as set out in those INDCs and consistent with a long-term decarbonisation goal. So I think to assume that the business is as strong and that it will do it regardless of governments, I don't think it's quite right, because, you know, in some countries it may have got to that point, the tipping point, which is great, but in many countries we're not, you know, many developing countries, that tipping point is still some way away, so we need to work very hard in that. In terms of, yeah, I mean, as you may recall, Anthony, I never worked on carbon markets. I was actually always worked, I worked on technology, I always worked on finance that was non-carbon finance. But I worked very closely with our colleagues from a developing country perspective, how carbon markets, carbon trading, the clean development mechanism could be effectively combined alongside other support measures, for example, in relation to the technology development and transfer process, as well as broader finance, such as finance through the climate investment funds, now the Green Climate Fund. And again, I think for me, it was always finding the right combination of measures that can be most effective and most efficient, not assuming that one tool is going to deliver, because as we saw, you know, and for, by definition, carbon pricing signals, whether it's carbon trading or carbon taxes, they go for the least lowest abatement cost, and so they're very good at driving investments in very cheap abatement options, but not so good at getting to those technologies that still needed to come down the learning curve, that needed to see the cost reductions that we are now thankfully seeing, in large part due to policies in Germany as well as China as well, that has put a huge amount into these sectors. So in terms of, and one aspect of this, and actually at E3G I was working, doing quite a bit of work in China around helping them to think through some of the states, provinces, around how they might start to look at carbon trading. And I think one aspect of that was very much how to, if you're going to auction, use auctioning. They seem to be very interested that actually was the most efficient, effective way of setting the price. Auctioning, take those revenues and put those revenues into some sort of green bank or fund, or to drive the next set of technologies. So you're sort of not just kind of, you know, they don't just get absorbed into the government budget, but actually use those resources, and then you're really getting a double, you know, bang for your buck, really, through the whole system. And I think we've seen, and Germany actually probably been the best in Europe that I'm aware of, in actually taking a big portion of the revenues from auctioning and putting them into their international climate initiative, as well as domestic technology development. Mm. So I think, you know, it's these are the sorts of things that need to be done in combination to drive the investments that are required, because we know we don't have time to wait for the carbon price to rise to a level that might be sufficient to drive investments in everything. We need to use the full range of tools in the toolbox.
Exactly. So I think Ingrid is keen to come in, but I want to bring Ingrid and Rita in. So please feel happy to respond to these questions, but also how we use carbon pricing to grow Europe's green market, if you like, low carbon market. And also there's a question, a sort of related question on the other side of that's come in, that around the UK steel sector that is struggling with huge layoffs and plant closures. And the UK steel sector has blamed the carbon price as the big reason why it is struggling and had to close down facilities. I think there's many who would take issue with that as the reason, but perhaps Ingrid, you want to go first and then we'll bring Rita in. Yeah.
I think that you had a very valid point before, saying that how to create a system that is sufficiently stable while at the same time being sufficiently flexible for an ever-changing situation. And I think that we can all agree that there is a need for regulatory certainty because of the long term of the investments. Well, at the same time, as we all know, the dramatic development that we've seen for the last 5 years was not expected by anybody, in particular not by the utility companies. And the development going forward should make us quite a bit concerned on two fixed systems. And that's why I think that what is will be absolutely essential, combined with the regulatory certainty that hopefully a COP21 political commitment can enable, is to have functioning market mechanisms in place. And ETS is such a system. So let's build on what we have. And also, if we can then link it to other carbon systems in other parts of the world, even better. And as long as you have those market mechanisms in place, you will actually have the motivation and the enabler for the financial system to come in. And then the market will work itself out. And it's moving quite quickly because, I mean, we are, for example, one of the biggest offshore developers of wind in the world. No, not in the world, sorry, in Europe. But anyway, we are not doing that ourselves anymore. And none of the European offshore developers are doing it themselves. They're doing it together with partners because it's the only way that you will have enough funds to do such a commitment. So it's getting there. It's going there day by day. So I'm quite convinced if we can only find market mechanisms, stay to that, this will actually work itself out quite quickly.
I think Europe decided to the ETS scheme, and we have learned a lot of experiences because the price sank so much so that we have the reform and the market stability reserve, because you need a certain price range to have a stick and the carrot. But we have also the discussion about carbon leakage, and the companies discuss if they go to perhaps to developing countries. And so that's important that we have linkages between certain systems, and we support, for example, China and other systems building up. If we get this linkage, you have a common market, and you have these discussions about carbon linkage in the long term. I'm convinced that we need in the agreement not only that we say we need the long-term goal and we want to decarbonize till the end of this century, but also a signal how we can use the carbon pricing, or how we can perhaps linkage some schemes which are working. So if we take it serious, the 2030 sustainable agenda, then all the developing and the developed states, we have to agree that we give carbon a price.
I want to jump in on this steel thing, because I was in Australia when the government was in the process of trying to change, when we had a carbon price in place and the new government was coming in. One of its poster childs was BlueScope Steel, right? And they were going on same stuff you heard from the UK from that question. You know, they're all going to shut down their plants and everyone's going to lose their jobs, all 700 people they employ. Now, I did a back of the envelope analysis on the emission footprint per dollar of revenue between BlueScope Steel and ArcelorMittal, who had taken the opportunity to embrace the EU ETS scheme, pre-advanced, started investing in new technology for steel manufacturing and reduced their emission footprint quite significantly. And BlueScope's was 60% higher, but they were using technology that was 40 or 50 years old. Mm. So the fact of the matter is they hadn't invested in the opportunities and the technology. They got what they deserved. Well, actually, what they got was for being the poster child for the incoming government. They got a $100 million transition bonus, right, which was given to them. Well, they didn't transition. They sacked 300 people anyway.
Yeah.
So the reality is they're not efficient enough to be price competitive anymore. That's the reality. If they can't change their business or seek someone to invest in new production facilities or new car manufacturing and production facilities like BMW have done, shut them down.
Well, this is a good point because, you know, and I guess, you know, we need carbon prices to change everybody's thinking. That in the UK, the media got very excited about the 1,500 jobs that would be lost in the steel plant, but pretty much ignored the 25,000 jobs that we're going to get lost in the solar industry because of the government's change of policy. So there is this sort of change in thinking. Now, we have a critical question that this is a great device. I'm quite enjoying this interactiveness for people to raise things. So we've been pulled up on the fact that we haven't really answered the question about linking. How, with so many local and regional carbon markets forming and likely to form, specifically, how will they eventually be brought under a single umbrella? Or should they? I mean, economic theory tells us they should, but that is a good question. And a sort of related question on the politics of pricing. Are a lot of internal carbon prices still based on assumed political outcomes? You know, are many of the pledges provided misleading? So interpret that question. I think it's more about the politics. I mean, for me, you know, and Wayne, we've discussed this, but I think it's a good question. Carbon pricing is the cheapest and most effective way to send the signal. But as we've increasingly found in many places, it's often the most politically difficult thing to implement, and more expensive measures quite often are easier to put in place politically. So perhaps we could talk a little bit about the linking, and I think the politics of creating a carbon market.
Well, I think a lot of people misunderstand what the word linkage really means. I mean, we can technically link all these markets today with the technology I've built. The infrastructure is already there. The decision to link is really more of a cross-political one, where you just have to agree that you'd allow certain credit types to transmit from one sector to another or from one market to another, and the rules for doing so, and then we can create that link. So it's actually not that difficult. I mean, Australia has had a link in place, for example, to allow the EU ETS, either EUAs or CERs, to come into the Australian market. They've now reassessed that to allow still the CERs to come in, and we're one of only a couple of companies in the world that can do that. But the reality is that you know, the linkages, the technical side, is not the hard part anymore. The difficult part is just getting people to understand it and make sure it'll still work. I mean, right now, for example, the CER market is, you know, floundering because the price has gone so low due to oversupply. The UN did such a great job of promoting the CDM process that the price of credits is so low they can't get investment into those CDM projects, and many of them are switching to the voluntary market. In the voluntary market interface, where you can those markets technically from the regulators are linked in California. So you're bringing voluntary produced offsets in as the offsets for the market there. The utilities are entitled by 8% of their obligation from offsets. They're only buying about 3% because there isn't enough supply, because the regulators didn't communicate with the voluntary market. They set rules that made it almost impossible to build the market infrastructure and get the investment. So basically, the voluntary credits aren't getting produced to bring into the market. So I think that this is where the engagement process, that I think suddenly everyone's starting to dawn on, that you need to have this cross combination. Government shouldn't go and isolate themselves when they're designing the markets or trying to work out a linkage. And you know, the business community needs to be willing and able to engage, even though it's not cost effective always for business. I mean, you know, it costs you a lot of money to go to these things and you think it's all full of politics. Do I really want to bother? So they've got to make a bit of effort to engage in the process. But more important, I think government needs to do that to allow them to come in. Okay. That's where it's got to head.
So we're winding up now because we've only got about another minute. But the politics. So I can bring in a politician and an economist, but we know it's politically possible. We've done it across 30 plus countries in Europe. Recently, Quebec and California linked, and they're sub-national governments in two different sovereign states.
Three more Canadians are going to join that.
yeah, also. And the G7 partners established a carbon market platform. I think that's important that we can develop a carbon markets together and we learn together. So the platform, I think it's the first step to for the linkage.
And I also think that, I mean, energy politics is still quite local and the systems are local, but the investor community is global. And as long as you don't need a technical link. As long as you have sufficient transparency, there will be arbitrage opportunities within the financial community in between. So they will translate between the different systems if there's only sufficient transparency.
Okay, so, and let's finish on just one comment from each of you, a couple of words. I mean, we now have many energy companies calling for a price on carbon. In fact, recently in the last few months, we've had CEOs of 10 of the world's oil and gas companies calling for a price on carbon. How important is that? And do you think that's a genuine call from those companies? So start.
I think so, yes. I think that the whole sector is embracing the change. We see business opportunities in the change as well. But we need some help and some push to get out of the old assets and the carbon price and the mechanisms for that. And in particular, the push from the both political side and the investor community to help us do so is necessary.
Wayne, closing comment?
I think that just when business and their clients start acting, then the message gets very clear to those businesses that are in the business of delivering energy. If the consumer market and the business market says, you know what, I want this to be green or I'm just going to do it a different way, I'll put my own installations in or whatever I need to do, then all of a sudden they've got to change as well. So it's not just that from the top down, I think it's also from the bottom up.
Rita?
I have a wish, and the wish is that we have a legally binding agreement. And in this agreement, we need a robust rules and transparency. And in that, we have also the carbon pricing, and not only talking, but also we have if we take it serious, the decarbonization. This must be into the draft.
And Emily.
Yes, well, it's obviously great to hear major energy companies calling for some kind of legal framework to tackle climate change. I think, as we've talked about, we're unlikely to see a single global carbon price coming out of this process. That was never intended as the nationally determined contributions imply. We'll see national and regional carbon prices coming out. And I think the linkage issue becomes very important moving forward, and then maybe we do get a single global price in the future. So I think it's important we don't consider that these calls from the energy companies that they would see a global carbon price as a sign of success or failure, because that, you know, was clearly never clearly on the table. But of course, a carbon price that is not incredibly high, which I think, as we've talked about, the politics often prevents a very high carbon price, would certainly reinforce more investment in gas as opposed to coal. So that, in that respect, it would then not necessarily, it would support the business models of many of the energy companies that are moving more into gas.
Wonderful, thank you. Well, unfortunately, Minister Tom Grosser, we were hoping he would get here for the last few minutes to make a comment, but unfortunately that's not been possible. He's been caught up in some important negotiation meetings. So please join me in thanking the panel, which I think has been excellent.